With respect to the charter schools, it's people are on waiting lists to go to charter schools. I mean, parents are crying when they don't get their number. They obviously have concern about their children, so much concern that they want them to try a different school. I would just urge you that if there is an opening by way of the governor's program, that you consider those parents and those children like any other children who happen to have made a choice that's a legal choice in the state of New York. Fair enough?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Right now, New York legislators are asking for your input to develop a budget by April 1st. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Logan-Dee. Today we're with Senate Finance Chairman John DeFrancisco. Senator, thank you so much for being here today.
And thank you.
So 3 days of hearings, over 26 hours of listening to people talk about the issues that they care about, and there are 10 more hearings to go. So let's start with local government. It lasted more than 8.5 hours. Explain what type of people you spoke with and what their ideas were.
Well, the major cities, all their mayors came in to talk to the legislature about, or the Senate Finance Committee and the Ways and Means Committee of the Assembly, to talk about basically their finances. And what got almost most of the ink was the question about the governor, the new mayor of New York, de Blasio's, call for the legislature to allow the city of New York to raise income taxes to fund a pre-kindergarten program. And that dominated what was going on, and the question I was asking at the top had to do with his view of life as to who should be included in that pre-kindergarten program. So the governor in the budget put money in for pre-K, and we thought that that would moot out the issue, since de Blasio campaigned on raising taxes to fund pre-K. Well, Governor Cuomo was talking about pre-K, funding it without raising taxes. And that's going to be one of the main rubs in this whole budget process. So that got a lot of ink. The other mayors basically were talking, and the people dealing with local government were talking about they simply don't have the funds. They need more aid to municipalities, and they need time to get out of this financial hole they're in.
Yeah, I would like to show the viewers a clip that we have of you and Syracuse Mayor Miner talking about pensions.
The peak, if not at the peak, of these pension costs. Have you made projections as to when this pressure is going to start being relieved?
Yes, we believe 2015, and then it will gradually escalate down. That's based on projections with numbers that we have used from the comptroller's office and also our own budget projections. But it doesn't drop off a cliff. It escalates down, which is why when you talk about this, this is not a continuing need, we believe. This is a crisis, and then once we can get back onto terra firma, if you will, we'll be able to pay for some of these.
Okay, and do you have any idea why that's happening? What's the logic behind the pensions going down, pension costs going down? Has it anything to do with the last two pension tiers, for example?
We don't believe it is. We believe it's more of a function of the fact that the baby boomers will be retired and out of the system, that the system will have worked through the crisis of 2007 and 2008. So there's a whole bunch of cost factors that go into what is our what's called the arc, but there's no simple answer. It's a bunch of factors.
Great. As a city resident, I'm not looking for you to bond, believe me, and I'm not looking for you to pay taxes. We'll see what we can do here.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
So she was basically saying, you know, making the tough fiscal decisions now is going to really help out in the long run.
That's correct. And when she said that the pension, the peak of the pension costs will be in 2015, then it starts going down. That's important, and I think it speaks well of her argument that we need help now. Let us get over this hump. We can't cut any more services. We just can't go to the taxpayers for more money, and the school districts are saying the same thing. So that's she made some good points, and we'll see what we can do.
Yeah. So there is a new revitalization program in your district. Do you want to tell us about it?
Yeah, it's revitalization of some property in the town of Geddes, the village of Salve, near Onondaga Lake, which has been cleaned, is being cleaned up, and there's been incredible progress over the many years that this cleanup has occurred. And I think it makes a lot of sense. And the part I like the best out of it is what's going to kickstart everything is an amphitheater there with 7,500 seats, an open-door amphitheater, and more seats on a grassy area facing the lake. So this is going to be a wonderful venue. I've always supported the arts in the community, and I just think this is an opportunity to showcase the great musicians, the great artists that we have, whether it be the Symphoria now and the other arts programs in the city. In addition, the State Fair is adjacent to all of this. And the area where they have the concerts now is deplorable, to be kind. It's just falling apart, and it's a terrible venue. And I would think that maybe some of the programs that they provide might be able to be held over there. Because I don't think there's any time soon we're going to be helping fund a major revitalization of that area. Plus, that's step one. Step two and three and four are to try to do some work in the infrastructure on the roads and the bridges around that area, and also some housing. And it would be a wonderful transition from a clean lake to the village of Salve in the town of Geddes. So it's going to be a great project.
Yeah, that's something that you really need.
Really need, it's in my Senate district. That's even better.
Right. When you were here last time, you talked about you were really interested in talking to the New York City mayor, Bill de Blasio, because you had differing philosophies. So how did that go? Was there any common ground?
We were very pleasant with each other. In fact, we talked the night before the hearing, and we had a cordial conversation. We just have different philosophies, period. And the pre-K issue is a perfect example. First of all, I don't think we should be raising any taxes now. We should be cutting taxes. We're just starting to go in the right direction. And to just send a different message by raising taxes in the city of New York, it just is a bad, bad message. When this plan is fully implemented, the governor's plan even, is fully implemented, the cost estimate by the Commissioner of Education was $1.6 billion. Now, it's a nice thing to start a program like that, and it's very few dollars, $100 million, I think, is put in this year. The start of the program never is a problem. It's the end years when everything is fully implemented. If you add another $1.6 billion to what's got to be done to fund education, a lot of people, including myself, say, now, wait a minute. Our schools are hemorrhaging. Some schools are at risk of financial bankruptcy. The state aid numbers that the governor is proposing this year for education do not fill the problem of these. It was nowhere near it. In many of my districts, it's actually less state aid than was given in prior years. So I think you've got to shore up the finances of the schools first, then start providing programs. You can't do them both at the same time. It may sound good, and I think many, including I think the School Boards Association, actually said exactly that. You know, they love pre-K. No one would have the political foolishness to say pre-K is not a good thing. Right. But on the other hand, you got to be able to afford it. Something's got to give. And in fact, with de Blasio, his program calls for taxes for 5 years, mm-hmm. and then no more income taxes. And I kind of challenged him on that.
Yeah, we have a clip of that because he has the dedicated funding stream, the lockbox. And you said on top of the teachers in New York City they haven't had a contract since 2009. Let's take a look at that right now.
Okay. You had mentioned that contracts and the open contracts and this program for preschool are like ships passing in the night. Well, it's one city. You know, you don't have the money on one end. You got to find the money for something else. And you indicated also that some of the costs for the pre-K can be realized by way of savings in some of the health care and some of the things that the city is not doing properly with their existing employees, that you can find savings in that. I would assume that's all interrelated.
Those other challenges existed before any discussion of pre-K and after school, and they have to be addressed separate from whatever we do. The revenue for pre-K and after school, lockbox, and specific and limited in its time. Those other challenges are much more eternal and have to be addressed through our overall budget approach.
Okay, the lockbox will be empty in the sixth year. And you don't think that'll be a problem funding it thereafter?
Well, that's why I believe that the efforts that we need to undertake at cost savings and in areas like employee health care costs and other areas will allow us over the five-year frame to get on the kind of footing we need to be that we can then sustain the pre-K and after school going forward. We could not sustain it today with the kind of fiscal challenges we face.
So do you think this could be a stable arrangement?
I just don't see how you have a lockbox, so you have a total of probably half of the $1.6 billion, $800 million, and then this tax stops in 5 years. I think it's just, give me the program, let me raise taxes on the rich, because that's his philosophy, and everything will work out after the 5 years. I find that hard to believe. I think one of the other witnesses, I may have been the chancellor of schools in the city of New York. I think I asked her, I asked somebody, I can't remember who, but I said that at the end of that time frame, how are you going to fund it? Well, we'll find a way. The same type of concept. Let us get started, and that's how we run into financial problems in the out years. You got to think ahead to make right decisions now.
Yeah, and that seems to be what Mayor Miner is doing. Right? And so it's like the opposite end of the spectrum there.
She's doing it correctly. She actually, the state allowed them to change the payout to pensions, how much you have to pay into the pension fund, and allow them to pay less now and more in later years to kind of ease in other words, to level off the payments in the next few years. She chose not to. She chose to bite the bullet now, which is the right thing to do, so that when those pension costs start going down, they get a big benefit, and it helps the city dramatically.
Right. Well, the next day was the education hearing, and that was nearly 9 hours. Commissioner King took questions for about 2.5 hours. So he says he doesn't want to roll back Common Core. Give us a briefing on that.
Well, basically, I don't think anybody has said they want to roll back Common Core, because everybody wants more stricter standards. No one said it at the hearing that I could hear. The concept is what about how quickly it was rolled out, and that's caused some of the problems, because some of the materials aren't ready. Kids are being teachers don't know what to teach to. The tests aren't fair for students if they don't know what they're supposed to be learning, and there's some merit to the quickness in which this is rolled out. And the Senate has come up with a bill to try to slow down that process. Senator Flanagan, the chair of Education Committee, and many of those proposals are very good ones. And the Board of Regents and the Commissioner of Education said that they're going to study this and try to relieve some of the pressure. So I think he's doing the right thing by saying we need the strong standards. If we need some modification of how it's rolled out, then we'll try to do something.
Yeah, you also brought up textbooks. There's a need to revamp and modernize textbooks. And one of the testifiers said there's no way to do that fast enough with the Common Core. Let's take a look at that right now.
Provide me with what the number is. I mean, how we can compute what is sufficient, because it's just criminal that textbooks are not being replaced in a timely fashion. And maybe, I know we're going to, apparently, according to the governor, we may have a bond act. It just seems to me that with online services and some, maybe it's a much more less expensive way, if we're getting technology into the classrooms to pay for those books. Maybe they'll help pay for those books by way of some other technology that everybody's using anyway nowadays.
Keep in mind that any textbook is outdated the day it comes out. If you have it takes almost 5 to 6 years to develop a textbook in mathematics and social studies. So in social studies, could be longer than 5 years. So by the time it comes out, it's already outdated and antiquated.
That's why online, if we get some technology,
absolutely,
would be very helpful. Well, one of the things that could help this is the governor is proposing a bond act,
right,
to get a technology in the schools. And if textbooks are obsolete when they're put out, then maybe we should be online with a lot of materials, and then they won't be obsolete. So maybe that's the answer.
Okay, so you're off to the transportation hearing now, and you'll come back and talk to us about it next time.
That's correct.
Great. Thanks for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on details of the 2014 budget process, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.